Sindi, that thing. Before you start doing the verse, people are like, Jesus. Hallelujah. Yeah, if I could sing, I would just sing a simple prophetic song. It says, Savior of the world, Redeemer of mankind, Lion of the tribe of Judah, Kinsman's Redeemer. Simple, that's Jesus. He's the Savior of the world, Redeemer of mankind, Lion of the tribe of Judah, Kinsman's Redeemer. Hallelujah. When I learn how to sing, I will sing it. Hallelujah. But basically, this is a song sung by God the Father concerning His Son. Because when he started, it says, I heard a song that God has written with His own finger concerning His Son. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I fear not. I'm just trying to calm my nerves because I'm very nervous and you guys are intimidating me. First and foremost, let me start off by saying, I'm gonna laugh because I love laughing and you can't stop me. And that is in no way a reflection of how highly I esteem you, but it is just my character. Hallelujah. So don't take offense. And we're gonna be reading from the Gospel of John, chapter 14, from verse 4 to 6, though we are dwelling on verse 6 as that is the theme of the month. Hallelujah. John chapter 14, verse 4 to 6. And with I go, ye know, and the way ye know, verse 5. Thomas said unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you. I thank you for your speaking, your spoken ones. You continually speak unto us. Father, I pray for grace to even dovetail the matters that were written aforetime that are useful in this generation. Father, I pray for grace upon grace, that precept might be upon precept, line upon line, here a little and there a little, that we might come to a place of open eyes, open scriptures, and open understanding, and that the eyes for understanding might be enlightened, that we might know you better. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. This is a difficult one, by the way. And let me preference this by saying or making a disclaimer. I'm going to say the things you know. I'm just going to say them in a manner that which I feel the Lord is leading us, and as well in a manner by which I feel we need to hear until we apply, that which you shall hear the Lord. Hallelujah. May I move this? Yes. Azara, please relax. Please smile. Please smile. They are gonna be sitting here and shoot us on Facebook smiling. Hallelujah. Amen. Okay, so first and foremost, Jesus is telling them about his departure. And when speaking about how you shall no longer be with them, then he says, but because I've spoken like this, none of you bother to ask where I'm going. And then they say that, okay, or first Jesus says that they know the way to the place where he's going. And Thomas says, we don't know the way. How can we when we don't even know where you're going? And then Jesus responds by saying that, I am the way, the life, and the truth. I'm just going to try to break this thing down so that we can be able to have full understanding of the whole thing. Hallelujah. Now, in order to understand Jesus being the way, we have to understand what happened in the beginning. Ne? So when God created man, yeah, you will forgive me. I'm gonna try to exegete this verse, but in my exegesis, it's gonna be more of an eisegesis. I'm just gonna write the verse as a wave. So you are gonna just forgive me and bear with me as I do that. So in the beginning, God created man in his image and likeness. And he blessed them and he gave him dominion to rule over the earth. Hallelujah. Yeah. You know, your faces are so intimidating. It's like the face of the lion dimension in this room. Can I trust God? Hallelujah. So when God created man in his image and his likeness, then man was in a place, in a realm called Eden. Eden was not a physical location, but it was a realm whereby God and man could meet. Because God created the earth for man, and heaven was God's dwelling place. So there had to be a midpoint where God and man met, and that place was Eden. So when man was in the Garden of Eden, there were two trees that were present there. Okay, there were a lot of trees that were present, but there were two that are in particular, and that are the tree of knowledge of good and evil and the tree of life. Amen. And man was given strict instruction that you shall not eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Because if you do that, you shall die, mut, in Hebrew. Meaning, you shall be separated from me, first of all, while you are walking on earth. And then you shall be separated from me eternally so when you are cast into the fiery lake of burning sulfur, which the book of Revelation describes as the second death.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So when the Bible is speaking about dying, it's not because speaking about physical death. Because to God, physical death is as falling asleep, because everyone will be resurrected. So he doesn't count that as death. But what he counts is the separation of his spirit from the spirit of man. I hope it's clear. Because Shaba already at the edge. Okay, it's fine. I'm trying not to go deep into things that will you know decrease my time, but let me just make sense of this. Because God in the beginning established a relationship with man. It wasn't about him domineering over a man, but it was him having a relationship with a man. Because in the cool of the day, God would just approach the man and they would talk. And nobody tells us what they spoke about, but I believe that they were just having sweet communion and fellowship. And when Adam had sinned, the first time we hear God saying, Adam, Adam, where art thou? Because the Spirit of God that was a resident in Adam had now been removed, because God and sin do not mix. So now, there then needed to be a way made back for us to return to the fellowship that we had with God. So Jesus comes and makes a declaration saying that, I am the way. So, the first part of it, Jesus is the way in putting us back to the fellowship with God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I'm going to visit my notes a lot. Reason being, I don't want to digress. Hallelujah. Maybe you can read Hebrews chapter 10. From verse 19. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 19 to 23. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way which he had consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, his flesh, and having an high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with true hearts in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised. Hallelujah. Because now, in the scripture, they touch the matter of the day, we have to go back again when we are dealing with the matters of the tabernacle. Now, we do know that God showed Moses a pattern, a symbol, a type of a tabernacle in heaven that he ought to build and establish on earth. And later it was built into a temple by Solomon. Now, this place was separated into three. And that was the holy place, the Holy of Holies, and the outer court. Okay, I messed up the order. It's the outer court, the holy place, and the Holy of Holies. Now, in the outer court, it is where everyone was allowed. Everyone from the Jews or who converted to Judaism was allowed in the outer court. That was the place of sacrifices. That was the place of washing of feet and so forth. And then you come into the holy place where only the priests were allowed. And those were of the descendants of the tribe of Levi. And then there comes the Holy of Holies, where only the high priest was allowed. And him only once a year. And the odd part about these three places, that God's presence was only found in one of them. And that was the one that granted access to one person only, and once a year. And it wasn't even more than an hour. And there was a veil that separated the Holy of Holies and the holy place. Meaning the priests were present, working and living on a day-to-day basis in the place next to the presence of God, but they would never come into the presence. Because the veil was a limitation, the veil was a hindrance, the veil was an obstacle between them and the presence of God. So now Hebrews says that we have been granted access by a new and living way through the veil, which is his flesh. So at the crucifixion process, Jesus knew the way he ought to die, such that he died even before the other criminals. And that prompted the soldier to come and inspect whether he was dead or not. And by driving a spear to his right side, that then opened up the flesh of Christ, and then blood and water came out.
Amen.
Which is seen symbolically as the burial of the church, but I'm not there. So, Jesus, the book of Colossians puts it better. It says it, for it pleased God to dwell in his fullness in Christ Jesus bodily. So the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost are all located in Jesus. So when he is at the cross being pierced and the veil is being torn from top to bottom, he is actually opening up an invitation to us to enter into his body, whereby the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit reside, and then we are no longer separated by a veil from the presence of God, but now we can live in fellowship with God 24 hours a day.
Hallelujah.
Because before the death of Jesus, the Holy Spirit in the Old Testament would come upon people and leave. But now we are the temple of the Holy Ghost. So now we have a much closer communion than the priests.
Hallelujah.
And God is so meticulous in his endeavors, because he first of all by declaring that we are priests. Meaning he gave us access to the holy place. And then by telling the veil, he united the holy place and the Holy of Holies. Meaning that now everyone has access to the presence of God. He is the way. Also, as I was reading, I found out something that if you are reading in your Bible and you happen to see a mountain, mountains are typologically representative of kingdoms. Ne? So when it makes reference to a mountain in the scripture, usually it's pointing to a certain kingdom and the strength of the kingdom. So in John chapter 4, we find Jesus speaking to a Samaritan woman. And as he's speaking to this Samaritan woman, she says that the Jews say that we ought to worship in Jerusalem, but our forefathers worshipped on this mountain. And Jesus responds by saying, "Verily I say unto you, coming is the time and now is where you shall not worship in this mountain or in Jerusalem."
Amen.
Ne? But The Father seeks such worshippers, they worship Him in truth and in spirit. They are mentioning two mountains, by the way. In Samaria, there was a mountain called Mount Gerizim, whereby there was a temple erected by the Samaritans, whereby they worshipped God. So he's saying, not on Gerizim, neither in Jerusalem will God be worshipped. Meaning it's not from a Jewish perspective, not a Gentile perspective, that God shall be worshipped. But I am translocating all of you into one place, and that place being me, Christ. And as he does that, the book of Hebrews then makes a presentation of another mountain. He says that you have come unto Mount Zion, the heavenly Jerusalem.
Hallelujah.
I don't want to get out of myself. Let me see how much time I've taken. Oh, too much. So, yeah, you can read Ephesians chapter 2, verse 14 to 18. Mount Zion. It's the kingdom of God. Because the odd thing, even about the Jews, though they had the law was not enough to give them the kingdom. Hence why, when Jesus speaks to his disciples, he says that do not fret or do not be afraid when they tell you the kingdom of God is there or over there, for the kingdom of God shall be in you. So the kingdom of God only came with Jesus, and that He is the only way by which you can access the kingdom. Okay, from verse 14. For He is our peace, who had made both one, and had broken down the middle wall of partition between us, having abolished in His flesh the iniquity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make in Himself of twain one new man, so making peace. 16. Yes, we'll stop at verse 18. And that He might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby, and came and preached peace to you which were afar off, and to them that were nigh. For through Him we both have access by one Spirit unto the Father. Hallelujah. So we have access through Christ. Because at the cross, okay, now the cross, if in case you didn't know, but I'm sure you do, the cross in itself is symbolic of the work that Jesus was doing on it, because they are horizontal and vertical sides to the cross, meaning that He was reconciling man to man. Because the Gentiles were separated from the Jews. But then He had to bring them together at the cross. And man was separated from God. And He had to bring them together at the cross. So there is a work of reconciliation that He is doing at the cross, such that the Jew can no longer be justified by observing the law that was given only to Jews. And the Gentile can also not come to a place of serving God in the way that is serving the many gods that we are worshipping. But we all have to come to a place whereby we are uncomfortably becoming a new man. Because you have to come out from your comfort zone as a Jew, as well as from as a Gentile, such that you might be able to gain access to the new life and have fellowship with the Father. Hallelujah. I'm just going to quote this one, Acts chapter 4, verse 12 to 18, which says that there is no other name given by which we can be saved. So the salvation that puts you in the place whereby you are now a candidate to receive the grace of God and have access to the Father, and have access to God, and God have access to you. There are many things of which I can touch concerning Jesus being the way, but for time's sake, I choose to stop there. And I want us to just look at Christ as the truth. Now, truth is simple and complicated, because truth, let me try to define it. Truth is that which does not depend on circumstance. Truth is uncircumstantial, unlike facts. For example, we can all decide in this room that someone is the best singer. Or that Joshua is the best keyboard player. Ne? There is a fact in this room. Ne? But when Mubebombata walks in, the facts change. But, you know, the truth is that which does not depend on circumstances. It's that which has been from the beginning and shall be at the end. Forgive me, Joshua. Yes, I'm a strength, I say I'm weak. Hallelujah. Yeah, so truth then is that which cannot be affected by situations and circumstances. Hence why then Jesus is rightly the truth, because all things were created for him, through him, and by him. Meaning he is the one that controls the circumstance of everything else, and everything else's circumstance cannot influence him. So he is he that has been from the beginning. And the word of God says that he is he that has God created all things and sustains it by the word of his power, Christ. Meaning truth is what is the reason for what you see. So Christ himself is the truth. Also, he is the truth because the Mosaic law or the Old Testament was a shadow of things to come, of which Jesus is the substance of those things, which are the better promises. Because in the Old Testament, when you look at, for example, we have the Ark of the Covenant. Jesus Christ is the Ark of the Covenant.
Amen.
We have the tabernacle. Jesus Christ is the tabernacle. We have many various things, and all of them are pointing to Christ. Even the Sabbath is not a day, it's a person. So, you have to come to that understanding. Those that do theology will understand that there is said to be a hermeneutical filter between the cross and the Old Testament. It's called a hermeneutical filter because hermeneutics is the art of biblical interpretation. So there is a difference in the manner in which you interpret the Bible after the cross and before the cross. Because the covenants are different. Hallelujah. I hope I am able to keep to time. Because now, Jesus is the substance as well. And this is shown as well in the fact that whenever truth is mentioned in the Bible, you find out that grace is not far from truth. Whenever you read about truth, there is grace. Somewhere, somehow, because it is also signifying the change of the covenant, the change of the dispensation, because now truth can only be revealed to those that are under the covenant of grace. Because by the wisdom of man, you can never attain to the truth, but it is by the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ that you are able to have a knowledge of the truth, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. So there is a liberty that comes when you come to relationship with truth. Grace and truth. Maybe I can touch a bit, because grace is also Jesus. Because grace is divided into three categories. Grace is unmerited favor, grace is divine enablement, and grace is the Lord Jesus Christ. So, he himself then shows you himself. There is nobody better to introduce me to you than myself. So that is why it takes grace to introduce you to truth. Because it takes Jesus doing you a favor that you did not deserve, that your eyes be opened up. Because there are people who have been studying and searching the law for years and years and can never see Jesus. Because as they acquire knowledge, they lose grace and lose Christ. I said there was a tree also in the garden. It's called the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And the reason why man fell is because he wanted to know good and evil, and hence he shifted from the dispensation of grace that God had ushered him into. Because when God created man, it's not that man didn't do wrong before he ate, but it's that because he didn't know it was wrong, the grace of God was enough. But now, when we have, because we were born with the knowledge of good and evil, when you commit a sin, there is something that happens in the inside of you, that condemnation that drives you away from God, that makes you feel unworthy, that makes you feel lesser than what you are. So, man fell when he started to try to become like God. Whereas God made man like himself in all areas except in the sphere of knowing good and evil, so that man might not worry about sin but enjoy the relationship. So grace and truth is sin there. And if you are to properly understand the grace of God,
it's not that
it's of lower standards than the law, but it's as a higher standard.
Because the requirements
of grace are so much higher than the requirements of the law. The grace says that you pray for your enemies and those that despitefully use you. I'm a naive. I long to hear. How? Yes, grace. The standard of grace is that much higher. The law says that thou shalt not commit adultery. But grace says, if you look at a woman lust, why? It is because God is not interested in the outer court. He is here in the Holy of Holies and the holy place, which have become one. Meaning that when you get born again, God's spirit indwells you. So you yourself also, you are a spirit, you have a soul, you live in a body. Outer court is the body, the things that we see you doing outerly. Holy place is your soul, your mind, your reasoning, your thinking. And then the Holy of Holies is where God's spirit resides along with your spirit. So when there was a tearing of a veil, then there was an overflow of the spirit. From only just being in the spirit, but now it has to influence your mind. That's why Romans chapter number 10, verse 2 would say, do not conform to the standards of this world any longer, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So now there is a transformation. So when you act out, it must be from a position whereby the change has happened on the inside. That's why Jeremiah 17:10 says, I the Lord search the heart of the man and examine the mind, so I can reward you according to what your gifts deserve, according to what your conduct is worthy of. So he's not interested in what you're doing, he's interested in why you're doing what you're doing. The grace of God is saying that what in the law you would have been dead, he's given you a second chance. Because the woman found in the act of adultery, in the law she would have been dead already. But grace says that your sins are forgiven.
Yeah.
Meaning, henceforth, the past has been eliminated. When a man is in Christ, is a new creation, the old is gone and the new has come. And says, go and sin no more. Now walk after the likeness of the manner of the creation you have become.
Wow.
So the standard of grace is so much higher than that of the law. Because the law would have a Pharisee company who were busy praying in front of people so that they can be recognized, but their hearts were evil. The scripture tells us about whenever they came into contact with a dead body, they would become ceremonially unclean. So some people would stumble upon old graves, because a grave at the Old Testament, it was a cave that was dug hole into, and many bodies were buried. And once it's full, it would be sealed up, never to be used again. So many people would come across those graves, not seeing, and touch them. And after you touch them, they become ceremonially unclean. So to prevent this from happening, they would then make it whitewashed. It would be painted, the robe on the outside would be cut, painted white. So the Pharisees are typological, or are the same as the white tomb, because on the outside it looks like they are doing good, it looks like they are perfect, it looks like they are righteous, but on the inside it's nothing but a bad smell and rotting bodies, because they are rotten on the inside. They have hidden agendas, they have hidden motives. So God is not looking for people with a hidden motives, but he looking for those that are doing what they do out of love. Yes. Hallelujah. We stand together. Okay, maybe if you read John 17:17. Say, sanctify them, Father. Oh, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth.
Hallelujah.
So, in the beginning of this very gospel, I feel like saying point of order. Point of order. This gospel, the gospel of John, the epistles of John, and the book of Revelations were all written by one John, the disciple of Jesus. John the Baptist died way before the crucifixion, so he couldn't have written this. Hallelujah. So, Saint John wrote all those books, so don't be confused. Amen. Okay, so in the beginning of this gospel, John makes an account saying, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And then he goes on to endeavor in verse 14 to say, the Word became flesh and dwelt amongst us. And we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten. So we understand that the Word of God is Jesus, and also it being Jesus, then when he says sanctify them by truth, your word is truth, he's saying sanctify them by me, because I am truth. So the only person that can make you clean is Jesus. That's why in Ephesians chapter number 5, it says that he is able to present unto himself a blameless bride without spot, without wrinkle, without blemish. He alone, no one else, he alone. So only through Christ can present to Christ you perfect, blameless, without spot, without blemish. Okay, maybe we can read John 16 verse 18. I wish for a Daniel. How be it, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. Hallelujah. So, when he, the Spirit of truth, okay, but weren't you just saying a few seconds ago that Jesus is truth, so how come it's the Spirit of truth? Okay, let me explain. Jesus speaking concerning the coming of Holy Spirit, he says, I shall pray the Father, and he shall send you another counselor. Now, the Greek words that are used there is allos parakletos. Now, allos means another of the same kind, and parakletos means advocate, counselor, and we see that word also used pertaining Christ in 1 John. So, when he says allos parakletos, he means another as myself. So, the Holy Spirit is exactly as Jesus is. Hallelujah. Amen. So, the Godhead, remember, these are just three expressions of one person. Hallelujah. Oh man, so he shall lead you into all truth. Meaning, there are some things about Christ that you need to learn from the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Also, when the Holy Spirit talks to you, he's not taking from himself, but he's taking from Jesus and ministering that to you. Okay. Yes. Okay, yeah, it's fine. So, as he ministers to you, he then brings you to the point of the renewing of your mind, such that you come to a place where you have the mind of Christ, according to 1 Corinthians chapter number 2, verse 16, which is, for we have the mind of Christ. Because if you start from verse 9, it's going to say that, okay, it's fine. It says that which has not entered into the heart of man, that he has not heard, I have seen, those things God has in store for those who love him. And then it talks about how no one knows the thoughts or the mind of the man except the man's spirit within him. Such is the case with God. Only the Spirit of God knows the thoughts of God. And then speaking and leading up to the declaration in verse 16 that says, for we have the mind of Christ. So the Holy Spirit is then a catalyst and an agent within us to bring us to a point and a place whereby we have the mind of Christ. And once the mind of Christ is in you, that is no longer you that is living, but it is the person whose brain or mind you possess that is living. So it's no longer you but Christ, because the Spirit of truth has ministered and dealt away with all tendencies of the old nature which we have put to death, because we all God is doing a new thing through you and through the new bed. And once your mind has been changed, then your life has changed. Because you no longer live the way you do. So now the life that is a pattern unto us is the life of Christ. So the standard, the thing that God was doing through Jesus was that we not only have the way to him, but that as we have the way to him, the Spirit of the way to him might change us to walk a life that he designed for us. If you read 1 Corinthians, let us read 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 45. I'm gonna close. Babare et umba arbet of shepherd umba and lab. Mandreba who's a breath here. Okay. Listen. And so it is written, the first man Adam was made a living soul, and the last Adam was made a quickening spirit. The first man Adam became a living being. The last man Adam, a life-giving spirit. Jesus. Okay, when God created Adam, he gave him life. But because of his rebellion, he forfeited the right to passing on life to others. Hence, the Bible would say, we are born in sin, shaped in iniquity. Because now we are born, if you read Genesis chapter 5, you find out that these are the generations of Adam, male and female Adam. And then it speaks about how that he begat them, or he had them after his own likeness and image. Not after the image and likeness of God. Because now he had fallen. Hallelujah. So he failed to then pass over life to those that he gave birth to. Together. Wonderful. So, he failed in relaying and transferring life to them which he begot, such that it took another in the same manner, in the same likeness as himself, which is Jesus, the last man Adam, to come and be a life-giving spirit, such that all those that first man Adam gave birth to death might receive life from last man Adam. So when you are born again, you no longer chase your life from Adam the first, but you chase your life from Adam the last. So you have Zoe life now. If I can go into Zoe life, I will never finish. Hallelujah. Okay. Let us read John chapter 1. From verse 4, and then I'm just checking if I've covered everything. Okay, in him was life, and the life was the light of men. That is Jesus, ne? And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. Another translation would say, the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot extinguish it. Yeah. Hallelujah. In him was life, and that life was light. Meaning, the life that Jesus was living gave hope in a dark world. And it was such in a manner that the darkness could not extinguish she could not comprehend it, such that the Pharisees and the Jews, they tried to discredit it, and we hear a man that was blind, that sent an account saying that, I don't know whether he's a sinner or not, all I know is that I was blind, but now I see. So the light cannot be extinguished by circumstances and people. So when you start to live the life that God designed you to live, you then become a people of light and of hope in your surrounding. The community is crying out because the church is not walking out or living the life that which you ought to be living. We are too busy with our own agendas, too busy building me instead of Christ. Because the truth is, you forfeited your life when you came to Christ. When you receive Him, you die, that He might live. Because He died in your place. So, there was an exchange of lives. And I just like to remind you that you have to then represent Him, because you are still just a false representation of Christ. The book of Romans would say, as many as are led by the Spirit, Romans chapter 8 says, as many as are led by the Spirit are the sons of God. I'm not disputing your sonship, but in sonship there are levels. There is Napios. No, it's called Napios, not Napios. Napios, which means a small baby that still wears nappies. That's the Greek. And then there is technon, which means a little lad, a boy that is a bit older, but they have not come to maturity. And the verse that I said, that as many as are led by the Spirit are the sons of God, that is the word hurios, which means a mature son worthy of the inheritance. So unless you are led by the Spirit, you have not come to maturity, you cannot then come to a place whereby you receive the inheritance. Yes, everything created was made for Jesus, and then we are co-heirs with Him, but you can never gain access to that inheritance until you follow the Spirit of truth. So as many as are led are the sons. So you have to then come to a place where you walk the walk. John chapter 6, verse 58. This is that bread which came down from heaven. Not as your fathers did eat manna and are dead. He that eateth of this bread shall live forever. This one is complicated. I'm just going to brush over it, because if I go into it, it's going to complicate things. Please, you allow me. Hallelujah. I'm just going to go over it. He's the true bread, and whoever eats of this bread shall live. So there is an inherent. There's an inheritance of life that you get from partaking of this bread, of which, contextually speaking, he was speaking of eating his flesh. If you read in the book of Hebrews chapter number 6, it would say that, let us not lay again the foundation of repentance from dead works, faith towards God, instruction about baptism, the laying on of hands, resurrection of the dead, and eternal judgment. God permitting, we shall do so. So those are six doctrines that are foundational that you need to know as a believer. And you have to move on to maturity. What is maturity? Maturity is eating the strong meat, of which there is the flesh of Jesus Christ. That is the seventh doctrine, the doctrine of perfection. But yeah, we shall not touch it now. Yeah, hallelujah. Can we just read John 5:39? Search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, and they are that which testify of me. This is Jesus speaking to the Pharisees, saying, search the scriptures, for in them them, you think you have eternal life. But they are speaking of me. Meaning the source of eternal life is not that which you are reading on paper, but the source of eternal life is a person. And I am that person of which it is written. Hebrews then says, long I come, in the volume of the book it is written of me. That is Jesus speaking. Meaning from Genesis to Revelation, everything you read there is all about Jesus. Amen. So you are searching the scriptures, and if you are searching them with an uncircumcised mind and with your own wisdom, then you shall in error lose or miss the eternal life. You are like a person that is going through an album with old pictures, and the person has come of whom the album belongs to, and you are still searching the album instead of encountering the person, because there is so much depth that cannot then be covered or shown by pictures, because you cannot see personality in pictures. You cannot have relationship with pictures. What am I saying? I'm not giving away scripture. Hear me correctly. I am saying that the scriptures should drive you to a point of fellowshipping with the person of that attribute that is revealed in the scriptures. Such that it is no longer a Moses walked with God and saw God as this, but it's a I know God as Abba. I know God as love. It's a personal thing, because it is all about transforming you such that you yourself might be an expression of Christ on earth. Let's read Acts chapter 17. Verse 28, sorry. For in him we live and move and have our being. As certain also of your own poets have said, for we are also his offspring. Hallelujah. And that was the one. In him we live, in him we move, and in him we find our being. Meaning, aside from Christ, there is no life. Whatever you try to do outside of Christ, that thing is a lie, because you are doing it outside of truth, and God does not recognize it. So you have to be in a place whereby you are living and walking out a life that is governed by God. And in his governance, it's not that he is not permitting you to do certain things, because by God's permission, many of you are here in this institute, in this time, for such a season as this, because you have to then influence and impact people around you with the measure of Christ that he has invested in you. No one else can minister the things you can minister. And we have a generation of people that are reluctant to speak, whereas there are people that know nothing, that have not been sent by God, that are given platforms and are speaking, addressing multitudes, whereas you ought to be standing in that platform. And it's high time enough you arise and shine, for your time has come. I know many of you are saying, I still need to grow more. You grow as you do. Paul was not familiar with the teachings of Christ, but the moment he got converted, we are told that immediately after the scales fell off from his eyes, he was seen preaching. He still had the mindset of the law, but with the zeal that he had, he preached. So it's not about eloquence, because God can show up in power when a person that has no knowledge of scriptures, all they know is that he come and got Jesus, Lina Manja, and that is enough. That's enough of a revelation for you in your grace, with your measure to affect your spirit. Yeah. It's not about reaching a certain standard. Let me tell you the truth. You will never reach a place and a time whereby you say, I have grown enough in the Lord. I am mature. I am ready. But it takes obedience, for obedience is better than sacrifice. So some of us make sacrifices and ministers fail to accept is this, that you are not called for every crowd. There are some people that as a minister I have had to personally chase away from my side because I have nothing in me that I can equip you with. So go to the place where you belong. So you must be able to discern right relationships. You might be moved by my preachings and it's fine, but that does not mean that I am the one that ought to cultivate you to the place of maturity. So God, now the scriptures record it very clear that He chose the places and the times in which you ought to live. That careful selection had a purpose. It wasn't just about it's gonna be funny from Msweli, no Skoniwe and Nzama. No, it wasn't about that. It was about what Koniwe can impart to Msweli and what Msweli can impart to Koniwe. It's simple. So we have a life that is not our own. We have a life that is positional from a place where we are in. Would you like to speak about this life?
There is no greater life except the life of God.
Amen.
The main purpose, as we are closing, for the coming of Jesus, He never came to give us water. He never came to give us clothes. He never came to give us any materialistic things. But He came to give us Himself. Because the Bible says, I am the way.
Yeah.
I am the truth. And I am the life.
Yes.
So He is the life of anything that you can expect. So when we speak about the life of God, my brother said it's a Zoe kind of life. And He has not come to so that He can have that life alone. But He has came so that we may share from the same life that He has. Because the Bible says He has came to give us an understanding. And this is the understanding that we are in Him, who is true. So whatever He says cannot lie. So the doctor's report is not a reality.
Amen.
Anything outside His mouth is not a reality. Let me say this. Before the foundations of the earth, brother, this lamb was slain for us.
Yes.
So the devil was already defeated. When we were lost in Adam, because the Bible says, through the disobedience of one man, we lost that life. But through the disobedience of one man, many were made sinners. But through the obedience of one man, Jesus Christ, who is the way, He has made us the righteousness of God. So the life of God in us cannot be corrupted by anything.
Amen.
Hallelujah. We have the life of God in us.
Amen.
Hallelujah. We have the life of God in us. And this is beyond the senses. You don't need to feel it, but you need to know it. Hallelujah. And this life cannot be separated from Him because He is that life. Thank you, brother. Hallelujah.
He is that very life. Yeah? And when you come to an understanding that He is this life, you then no longer walk in your own accord, but then you walk with the fullness and the boldness of the understanding that as Jesus is, so are we in this world. Therefore, when you are as Jesus, Jesus said that you have seen me, have seen the Father. So if you are like Jesus, that means that you are like the Father and you are bringing glory to Him. ask, what is your life saying about God? It's just a simple question. Because Paul says that we are letters. So as we are walking and living letters, what are we ministering? What message are we relaying about God? Remember, we have been given this life of Christ. That this life might be the light of men. Has your life given hope to anyone recently? Has your life given any hope to anyone? Maybe we're going to close our eyes and just pray briefly. Because it's not by might nor by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. So it takes the Spirit of truth to lead us to a place whereby we are walking out and living out a life. Unfortunately, I've been trying to ignore something, but I shall address it. Please forgive me. It's going to take just a few seconds, I believe, or a minute. Honorable Chairperson, some gave me to. This is the word of the Lord unto you. It says that, behold, I am locating you, and I am putting you in a position where you shall confuse many, because I see that many shall be tempted to confuse even your administration, because I see that there is a strong apostolic grace that flows with your prophetic office, because the Lord has called you to minister and raise up people that are prophets. So it takes for a strong apostolic grace to mentor and govern prophetic people. So the Lord says that I shall begin to then sound you as a trumpet in this season, and many people from various areas and various spheres and ministries shall then begin to hear the sounding of this trumpet and shall draw nigh unto you. The Lord says that be faithful and say only that which is saying, because some will come to you and leading you towards a certain direction, that you might speak certain words that are of comfort to them when the Lord has not spoken them. He says, be faithful and diligent in dismissing your prophetic office. Only say that which I say, and only do that which I say, do. This is the word of my Father to you. So he says, take heed and do not allow them to call you an apostle when you are a prophet with apostolic grace. Amen. May we just pray.